Hello, and thank you for joining us. Welcome from me, Michael Scott, in the UK, and from Joint Convener Sanford J. Ungar in Washington, DC, to this 16th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is the director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished panel and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session. From the start, you can type in questions to the panel by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try and put them to the panel to consider later on. We urge you to ask questions as soon as you can, and I will try to put as many as possible to the panel. But please use the Q&A button, not the chat button, the Q&A button. With that, I'll hand over to Sandy, and I'll see you later. Sandy.
Thank you very much, Mike. Delighted to be with this distinguished group of panelists this morning as we talk about a subject that sort of often lurks in the background and doesn't get the kind of attention that one might expect it to, given the role of veterans. So we'll be talking about the neglected voices of veterans, military veterans worldwide today. Just to identify our panelists briefly, Renee Burbank is Director of Litigation at the National Veterans Legal Services Program based here in Washington. Travis Hoare is Senior Director of Government Affairs at the Iraq and Afghanistan Veterans of America, a relatively new organization compared to some of the old stalwarts that is devoted to the needs and the issues specifically of veterans of the conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan. Professor of psychiatric and mental health nursing in the United Arab Emirates, and he's coming to us from far away today, but we're very grateful to have him. And then Sean Woodland is Deputy CEO and co-founder of Woody's Lodge, a veteran service organization in the United Kingdom. I'd like to start with the very broad question and that has become clear as we prepared for this program, that notice in these complicated and difficult times, which seems to me very ironic given the role that they have played in very central things that have grabbed our attention for quite a number of years. Richard, I wonder if you might first address this question. What is the biggest obstacle you think that...
I've lost. I think the question was around the voice of the veterans. Sorry,
the issue of why so many veterans feel as if they've grown invisible, despite their central role in issues of our societies and cultures.
It's a cyclical problem. Going back to since the dawn of time, we've got conflicts that are going on. Individuals come back from these conflicts, they reintegrate to varying degrees of success back into societies, and their narrative is either lost or is misunderstood by the general population. And what we've got are veterans coming back into mainstream society, and their experiences are not truly understood by the general population. The general population has been watching the conflict through a sanitized viewing lens, media, television, and so on. And so veterans coming back, their experiences and their voice are camouflaged, in that and once the conflict is over and the political interest within that conflict may come to an end, the veteran's narrative becomes quieter, and it may not have the political agenda that it had previously. So it's one of not being understood, I think the case is that we try to reassimilate these individuals back into society, and they've had huge experience within their life, and they themselves then have to try to work through some of those experiences and take on a new role through transitioning to a civilian identity. And I've seen this not only within the United Kingdom, but recently completed work within the Middle East, in the transitioning of individuals after conflict, after being in the armed services. And it's not an issue that is just to one country. It is a dilemma which is global. It's a global issue. So yes,
Rene, you represent veterans in court.
We represent, and so, not just please. In court. Well, we also represent them before the Department of Veterans Affairs and before boards in the military specifically. But I interrupted. Continue.
No, that's quite right. I interrupted you. So do you have an explanation for this sense of voicelessness on the part of many veterans and alienation?
Yes, I think it's important to tease out that veterans are not a monolith, right? So I think there are certain subpopulations of veterans that in particular feel isolated more than others. It's not always a growing sense of invisibility. For example, LGBTQ veterans in the United States certainly have historically been silenced and sometimes forcibly. And actually, I think we can say that that's actually improving in the last decade rather than getting worse. But I do think that in terms of increasing isolation, there are two factors that I really see as in the United States, at least, a critical component of this. One is just that military and military families are more separated from the rest of the civilian population, right? When you have an all-volunteer military, right, the military itself, most people who are active service members have family members who served. If you didn't have a family member who served, you likely don't know anyone who serves. And so there's a separation of whose stories do you even hear about? Whose narratives are you even aware of? And then I think also there's the second strand I want to highlight is just that there's an increasing number in the United States in the last 20 years, in the Iraq and Afghanistan era in particular, of former service members who are not treated as veterans, who are actually, according to the Department of Veterans Affairs, not even called veterans because they are separated with less than honorable discharges, in particular, other than honorable discharges. That means not an honorable discharge, not a dishonorable discharge, not someone who is court-martialed, but rather just an administrative separation related to often misconduct because of untreated PTSD or other mental health conditions related to combat service. Those people are separated and then kept out of services, kept out of the narrative of what it means to be a veteran. They're told by the government, you are not a veteran. And they will often not identify as veterans to other people, to their employers, to their to people that they meet. They don't talk about their experience because of the stigma associated with that that discharge. And that's something that MVLSP has been working on for many years now, working to try to get the VA and other parts of the government in particular to recognize those veterans and provide services, and also to alleviate that stigma so that their voices can be heard, so that they can speak out and feel like they have a place in what in the identity of what it means to be a veteran.
I'm sure they feel as if they're veterans, whether they're categorized that way or not. Travis, this is an interesting thing, and you and I were talking the other day about this, actually. The small and actually seriously diminished percentage of American families, American people who have some, who feel some connection with the armed services because of a family member having served. End of conscription, the end of the draft, the very serious change in how these issues are presented to the public. I suppose that's something that's very much at the heart of the work of your organization.
Yeah, that's one of the things that we work on is, you know, getting our stories and the post 9/11 generation stories out into the public sphere, because as Renee mentioned, so few of Americans serve nowadays, you know, less than 1% are serving, which makes it even harder to get our stories out of the public, because it's just a lot of people don't know a veteran. And it's very much a family business almost, serving. So yeah, people are inspired to serve by family members. Myself, my two brothers served, which inspired my older brother served, so which inspired me to serve, which inspired my younger brother to serve. And that's kind of moves along. And then service members marry other service members. So it becomes a very insular community. And not a lot of people understand it outside of it. And I think civilians might be hesitant to talk to veterans about their experiences, things that Richard mentioned, and veterans might be dealing with their own issues. So they don't necessarily want to share their, they might not want to share their experiences with their civilian friends because they don't think they'll get it. You know, we do a survey every year, or bi-yearly, and we ask our membership how they feel about certain things. And one of the things that we ask is, do you feel like Americans understand the sacrifice of service members? And less than 20% of our members believe that. And I think it's also interesting to say that over 65% believe that they are supported by the American public. So our generation does feel support, but they don't necessarily believe that the Americans understand, which I think is an interesting dynamic with our generation of veterans. And as you mentioned, the draft is gone. Our generation of veterans are deploying more times rather than a lot of veterans just deploying once or twice, as we saw in previous eras. So I think all of those compound these issues of getting our stories out and making our voices heard with the general civilian population.
Sean, is there a similar phenomenon in the United Kingdom? And what do people like you try to do about this? You're muted, by the way, before you...
Yeah, thank you. We're definitely similar from what Renee was saying, what Travis is saying. You know, I feel that our veterans, they feel like they go from zero to hero. And then when they come out, then they're hero to zero. So, you know, they're not being heard. I think that we need to educate organisations and employment, which is why we have the employee recognition scheme over in the UK. I feel that education is definitely plays a big part, and the signposting that we do in the organizations that we sort of like refer veterans on to helps them to be heard.
What does Woody's Lodge do?
So we support veterans through activity, mentoring them, help them, you know, with support that they need through housing, form filling, that sort of thing, you know, just really basic support that they don't get. That, you know, a lot of military veterans, they join at the age of 16. And that's all they know is the military life. They come out and then they don't know what organizations to go to. They don't know where to go for health advice. So that's kind of what we do. We support the veteran and we signpost different organizations that will help.
That brings up the issue of homelessness, which I gather is a problem for many veterans, both in the US and the UK, and I suspect in many other countries as well. Is that getting any better? I don't know who wants to take this question. Is homelessness a growing problem for veterans, or is it something that's beginning to be solved? Richard?
Thank you. It is, and I, from knowing Woody's Lodge, I know that it does exceptional work in, working collaboratively with veterans that, are homeless. But the homelessness is an issue. And I remember the first time I sort of encountered this dialogue and this discussions around this, there was almost an explanation that, well, this was in the 1980s, and it was in a city in America, I think it may have been Detroit or Chicago, please forgive me, but an explanation was that, veterans, especially infantry, have lived in rough conditions, so there's almost, they almost don't mind living rough on the street. And they're better conditioned to this sort of way of life and things like this. It's less stress. And if they've got PTSD, they're seeking almost a more simpler life, which obviously is, there's huge sociological, and usually health issues that need to be addressed and supported there. And we've had some innovations within the UK where veterans have been trained in building houses or repairing houses that have been derelict for a long period of time to try to reclaim some of those properties. There is some great organizations that deal with this, and there is a veteran population, obviously, within our homeless population, which is continuously being addressed. And often it's like, King Canute, holding back the tide, but it's an issue that needs to be addressed. And what we'll find if we go back to, the currency of a veteran is that if the war is finished, they go further down on the political agenda. And so, in terms of priority for housing, social housing within the UK, they'll go lower down on the agenda for getting support with housing. And that's why organizations like Woody's Lodge are so crucially important in supporting those individuals. So yes, to go back to your question, Sandy, homelessness is an issue, and it's a continuing issue.
Renee, how does the homelessness situation impinge on your work trying to get veterans and their causes heard?
Sure. I mean, homelessness makes it everything more difficult, right? And that's true whether you're a veteran or not a veteran in terms of interacting with the sort of social service benefits, just not having a easy to reach a place where you can be reached, not having internet access, not having the opportunity to sort of have one that stability, a housing situation that creates all sorts of ripple effects in the rest of the ability to get treatment, the ability to get benefits, the ability to get the sort of legal assistance, things like filling out forms, right? That sort of thing becomes much harder when you are experiencing homelessness. I did want to also just briefly try to answer your question about whether it's a growing problem or a sort of problem that's getting better. So at least in the United States, the adult homeless population has more veterans than in the general public. So there are more, you are more likely to be homeless if you are a veteran than if you are not a veteran. That, however, has been decreasing. So the number of veterans experiencing homelessness in the last decade has actually decreased 40%. So even though it is still worse, that gap has been closing. So it is something that in the United States, it has been a policy priority. I think Richard's point that it's in part because there's been such a tension on the ongoing theaters of war, that there has been that attention. And certainly now that the United States has left Afghanistan, that we are trying to think about this as over, the war is over, how that's going to affect the way veterans are prioritized in the future is certainly something that that we need to pay attention to, that we need to remain vigilant, that, that homelessness for veterans is an incredibly important problem. And certainly, it, as I said, it has all these ripple effects on all these other aspects of engaging in civilian life, engaging in social society, and in making sure that you can get the assistance and benefits and care that you need. Because obviously a lot of these veterans who are homeless are those who have the highest needs in terms of support requirements.
I'm not sure to whom I should address this question. I'm sorry, Richard, you wanted to add something.
Just very, very briefly. The challenge in answering your question, Sandy, is quantifying. You know, is the issue getting higher? Mm-hmm. And the issue is stigma and shame. And often very proud individuals that have been in glorious or, you know, cause regiments, you know, very proud of their service history, is sometimes they won't identify as being a veteran. Now, possibly so if there's some access to some support services. But sometimes what we've, and this has been found within the criminal justice system, and this is why it's so crucially important to have peer support services where veterans are engaging with veterans. But stigma and shame often precludes individuals from identifying themselves as veterans. And then we don't always know whether the numbers are going up and down. I just wanted to
make... No, that's very interesting. Travis, I don't know whether you... know an answer to this or not, but are there some countries that are models that seem to handle this problem better? I suppose there aren't. It also depends what period we're talking about. But are veterans welcomed home more universally, more enthusiastically in some other societies that you're aware of?
I'm not aware on a country scale. I know that, you know, just speaking for the United States, I think there's been a generational shift of how we have treated our veterans, or how the veterans are, I guess, are more perceived by the public. You know, thinking back to the Vietnam generation, and hearing stories from Vietnam vets and friends, parents that were Vietnam vets, and their treatment when they came home was very, very different from my experience coming home from Afghanistan. So I think just generationally, it's changed. I think the Vietnam generation did a lot to work on that and to explain to the public that, you know, no matter how you feel about the wars, no matter where they are, you shouldn't take it out on the veteran who is there. As we mentioned, because of the draft, many times it wasn't even their choice to go over there. So I think that we've shifted in how we view veterans, and we've, at least in the United States, I think we've done a better job in separating them. Of course, there's still issues that can come up from that. But as far as a country scale, I'm not too familiar with, and I'd be very interested to hear, you know, the UK experience from generation to generation, if that's what that is like. Yeah.
Sean, what can you add on this subject?
Yeah, we see homelessness within our organisation, but I think as an organisation, we know organisations to help those veterans. I think it goes as far as, you know, the veteran isn't identifying as a veteran, like Richard was saying. But yeah, you know, we have other organisations that can help. There's lots of organisations out there. And I think as an organisation, because we know those organisations, as soon as that veteran engages with us, we're able to support them and help them. And sometimes with our organisation, it's a case of helping and supporting that veteran before it gets too far.
Right. I have the impression that France in particular, perhaps for idiosyncratic reasons, has always elevated its veterans and honored them in a certain respect. A lot of military memorials that are central to French culture. And then they had this strange experience in the 1950s and 60s where many of their own military veterans were in rebellion about in Algeria. They had a secret army organization fighting against the French, and then had this problem of how to deal with these different factions. I don't know whether that's something, Richard, that you have some perspective on.
There's a lot roaming around in my head at the moment. I mean, obviously, you know, your topic over, you know, how do we treat veterans and how are they perceived? You know, from the UK image, you know, we're coming up to the 40th anniversary of the Falklands conflict, which, you know, you'll remember, you know, the days of Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. You know, Ronald Reagan was always, you know, fond of quoting the Muslim philosopher Ibn Khaldun about the cyclical approach to things, and you know, if we don't learn, things come around. And from that 40-year anniversary that we've got now with the Falklands, that was a conflict that was post Second World War, was seen as, you know, one of our finest hours. But other conflicts come along and wax and wane in terms of their popularity with the general public. Now, the veterans aren't always blamed for that. You know, they're not blamed for that. You know, it's political agendas that, you know, that are blamed for that. Politicians that may have led us down a path that we didn't want to go down. So I think the identity of a veteran is cemented within certainly the British identity through, you want to call, you know, militarism, but we have a very, very strong relationship with our armed forces, and it's part of our national identity, the armed forces, very much so. And so we always try to support to varying degrees our veteran community. In terms of what you were saying, you know, are there any countries that are better than others? I'm highly biased on this, Sandy, but Wales is a country that is exceptional in supporting veterans, albeit there's always opportunities to improve. But there's national services, similar to your VA in America, Veterans NHS Wales, Woody's is an example of a national organisation, Change Step. You've got organizations which have gone not regional but are national within their support. And I think, other than failures to set up the US Veteran Treatment Courts that Judge Russell set up in 2008 in Buffalo, New York, I think, you know, that is an example of a country that has really tried to support its veteran community. The last point, and if I may, and I'm conscious that there's probably a few record buttons that have gone on when I came on, but I have to say that within the GCC region in the Middle East, there is a great respect for individuals that have served in the armed forces.
GCC being the Gulf Cooperation Council.
Yes, within the sort of the Middle East, which, you know, which I can talk about, is that there is a great respect for individuals that have served. And sadly, in 2015, where we had you know, a large number of deaths within the country I'm in now, within Yemen, the Yemen conflict, there was a national flood of support for those individuals who referred to now as martyrs, and the supporting of their families, you know, not just in terms of social, but financial support, and to the future of those families, which has been, to some extent, far more than I would have seen in veteran families in other regions of the world. So there are examples I'm giving here in the Middle East, and I'm giving, you know, in Wales, particular examples of excellence, I think. Thank you.
A particular issue that seems to have united veterans, and especially recent veterans, in the United States is this one of burn pits, in particularly in Afghanistan and Iraq. Travis, maybe you can explain. I think it's a surprisingly low profile issue given how serious it is.
Yeah, and I was just thinking about this, of how this burn pit issue is kind of a microcosm of what we're talking about generally, of this disconnect between the civilian divide and the veteran divide. A burn pit is something that any veteran hears, at the post 9/11 generation veterans hear, and I think they immediately know what it is. And it's something that a civilian might hear and they probably have no idea what it is. So a burn pit is exactly that. It is a pit where we burned, the Americans burned all of our trash at every base in Iraq and Afghanistan and other places that we deployed post 9/11 during the global war on terror. And when I say everything, I really do mean everything. And it's just to quantify this, you know, the human waste, there's no sort of sewage that we had, no sewage system, human waste, just the trash waste from meals ready to eat, the MREs, all the plastic water bottles that we were burning. And all of this was put into a pit of varying sizes. So me, for example, I was on a patrol base in southern Afghanistan in 2010 that had 9 Americans, 8 Afghan National Army soldiers. So 15 people living on a base, and all of that trash, there's no running water, no running water that we could drink. So all those plastic bottles that we're drinking every day was all put into a pit, about a 8 meter by 8 meter dug hole in the ground. And every night we would get about a gallon of diesel fuel and spread it all over the pit and light it on fire. And our base was about 25, 30 meters by 25, 30 meters. So we slept next to it, we ate next to it, we lived next to it for 7 months. And that's not a unique experience, unfortunately, but it's not something that veterans really talk about in their daily experience when they come back and they're like, oh, how was your deployment and things like that. They're not gonna bring up the burn pit. It's something that I think veterans just, I was in the Marine Corps Infantry, and it was just, we showed up and we were like, okay, this is what we're doing. This is what we have to do to get the mission accomplished. This is just one of those things. And I didn't think about it honestly again until I started working at IAVA 4 years ago, and we really started to put a highlight on this issue as we had the health effects, as I'm sure everybody is thinking, that are coming down the road now. And these pits were used for 20 years. And my example was very small. And then there's very, very large bases like Bagram Air Base that were kilometers wide. They were enormous. And there were people constantly moving these pits around and this trash around. And it was just constantly burning huge plumes of smoke in the air. And that's just one of the toxic exposures that we were exposed to. Burning oil fields in Iraq, just the huge cities that we were in that didn't have modern sewage systems. So as you can imagine, the things that you're just breathing in, just living your life and trying to just live out there. So there's a plethora of exposures that our generation has been exposed to.
Yeah, you don't have to be an environmental activist to get a sense of what a disaster that is, how horrifying it is.
I mean,
Renee, is this emerging now as an issue in the legal system that's getting dealt with properly, the burn pits?
Yes, yes to the first part of that question. It is an emerging problem. Whether it's being dealt with properly, I think is certainly up for debate. And whatever progress is occurring is occurring very slowly in terms of the lifespan of a veteran who has been exposed to these toxic chemicals, this toxic waste. You know, time is of the essence. So the government moves slowly. It can move on the order of decades for some things. We at MVLSP, we are still dealing with toxic exposure of the Vietnam generation, of Agent Orange exposure is still something. We have a class action that we have been involved in since 1987, right? We are dealing with veterans who have died, and the surviving family members are still trying to get the justice and the benefits that their family member was entitled to. So the current generation, knowing what has happened in the past with toxic exposure in particular, trying to make that something that we we address more quickly, more thoroughly, and more extensively is really a top priority of IAVA, of MDS panel, and a lot of organizations that are focused on the burn pit issue. And in particular, I think it's important to note, Travis sort of mentioned this almost in passing, right? That this was for 20 years, the entire period, basically, of our involvement in Iraq and Afghanistan used burn pits, even though, as you say, Sandy, it's not like anyone, it was not a mystery to people that this was going to be a problem. There were reports early in the Iraq and Afghanistan conflicts that, in fact, this is a problem. We should stop. This is going to be bad. And still, as late as 2019, there were authorized burn pits being used in Syria and some other countries in Southwest Asia by the US military. So it's a recurring issue. And certainly there have been some proposals. There's an act called Honoring Our Pact Act that's been passed by one chamber of Congress, the House, but not the other. So it's not law at the moment, but there has been this sort of a coalescing place for not just burn pit issues, but a whole host of toxic exposure issues. Again, ranging decades, things like for radiation exposure for a nuclear disaster in Spain in the 1960s, that wow. is still something that veterans are still trying to get and trying to get their voices heard. And I want to just mention just one additional part of this is also bringing back to the voices question of being able to speak their mind. A lot of these details of how veterans have been exposed to toxic exposure involves issues where they have been told specifically they're not allowed to talk about it. It's a matter of national security. And so veterans who have been told that this is not something to talk about, it's just part of getting the mission done and it's not something to bring up. It's really something to overcome when they come back and are facing these issues and trying to get those issues remedied.
That is a very strange thing that people are ordered not to talk about it. There's a problem unique to the UK that I also wanted to bring up, which has to do with the troubles in Northern Ireland and people who served there. And I gather there's been a lot of controversy over what their service involved, how they performed, and different factions holding each other responsible. And apparently that's a problem of a different nature, but that just doesn't go away at this point. Richard, can you bring us up to date on that?
Well, it's as a boy raised in the Middle East, and then going back, and I like Sean, I served as well, and I, I'm still blown away by the complexities of that conflict. The troubles, Operation Banner. There's been, obviously it's been in the case recently because of the prosecution that's been brought towards serving soldiers, whose argument is that they were doing as they were informed to do, as they've been trained to do. And, we've had some high profile individuals, and you're talking about free speech. And individuals I can think of like Johnny Mercer and Rory Stewart, exceptional individuals who were members of parliament, who attempted to highlight, who had served themselves, who had that experience of the armed forces, who then tried to be the voice of the veterans. And I don't think Sean can jump in, but I don't think I'd be controversial in sort of saying that Johnny Mercer felt that he had to step down from his role as a member of parliament because he was being sidelined in being able to support the Northern Ireland veterans. Similarly, and this is only my interpretation, when Rory Stewart was given initially the role to lead the government review on veterans in the criminal justice system, of which I was tasked to look at, see if we could replicate the veteran courts, the American veteran courts within the UK judicial system, of which I failed. I did put three models forward. Those individuals have been quite high profile in trying to promote change and Johnny Mercer in particular, his support for those Northern Ireland veterans has been the loudest. I was going to use the word there divisive, but I think it's just it's a case of a conflict, which, you know, Ireland is our neighbour, and it's so historically ingrained within within the two nations, and it is divisive within sort of the south and the north within Ireland. I don't know, perhaps Sean served as well, perhaps she'd like to add something.
Sean, do you want to add to that?
To be honest, I don't really have a lot to add to that. I'm 20 years a veteran now, 15 years a veteran. But no, I think Richard's covered it. I don't really have much to say on Northern Ireland conflict, other than we do see Northern Ireland veterans that are still suffering.
We'll go back to Mike in just a moment to take some of the questions. But Travis, I wanted to ask you, are there issues like this that you're aware of? I mean, is there still an overhang of Vietnam in the veterans community where people are worried about, as far as you know, and maybe Renee, you want to weigh in as well, worried about being pursued for things done many years ago in their capacity as members of the armed services?
Yeah, I think relating it to Vietnam, again, I think it can't be really overstated how much work the Vietnam generation did in kind of changing the image of it. And I remember I was in middle school and high school when the Iraq war was starting, and that was a very, very unpopular war in America, at least, being a kid and seeing it and hearing it talked about as being very unpopular. But I always remember that it was also with the caveat that we can't blame, and I use that in quotation marks, the veterans who go there, because they did sign up to serve their country. And, we can't put the policy failures or decisions on the boots on the ground type of veteran. And that's something that we need to separate. And I think that America generally did a good job of separating. And there was, obviously there's a lot of veterans that have been sidelined. A lot of the veterans that Renee talked about in the start, the LGBTQ community, homeless veterans, veterans of color, could be very, very marginalized and kind of erased. But I think generally the work of the Vietnam generation of separating the veteran and the policy decisions did a good job in America. When you say that you're a veteran, there's a kind of respect for like the average person, they say it for better or worse, I think that's how it is in America, at least.
Renee, anything to add there?
Yeah, I wanted to just bring up something that that hasn't been raised yet, but is certainly a very large topic for veterans and veterans policymakers, which is sexual violence in the military, and in particular, an increased attention into how the culture of the military both is in its own way a silencing effect for many people who experience military sexual violence, and that makes it more difficult for them to integrate into, not just when we're talking about civilian life, being a veteran, integrating into the veteran specific spheres of even the VA, when you've experienced that kind of betrayal from within your own sort of organization within the military structure itself, it's distinct from the sort of the narrative that we've all been talking about, this idea of combat and being deployed and what it means to be a veteran who was in a certain type of military conflict that we think about. There's actually a whole host of other parts of the military experience that aren't related to combat that are much less discussed, that are much less seen with much less sort of, you've served your country, we recognize that when you've deployed, but it's a little bit harder to talk about how your service relates to your military sexual assault or other types of injuries and problems that can occur from things unrelated to deployment.
Right. I appreciate you mentioning that because we do mean to include it as one of the issues that seems not, we haven't quite found a satisfactory way of dealing with it. Mike, I'm going to turn things back to you and see what questions have come in and what areas you might like to explore now with our panelists.
Yes, thanks everybody. I find this quite emotional actually, listening to what you're saying, and it's taken me back. Let me just ask a question really that's coming from me really. It takes me back to my childhood in the 1950s, in which I knew people from both the First and Second World War. In fact, my great uncle and aunt, I used to go to their house, and sometimes my aunt would just stand up and go into some kind of trance. Everybody said she was having a turn, they said, you know, and she'd just wander about the house and go into the kitchen and start to try and make tea or something. And nobody really knew what it was, but what it actually was the fact that in the Midlands, in the United Kingdom, they'd been bombed and bombed and bombed. Because of factories nearby, just in the same way that Crimea is, the Ukraine is being bombed now. She lived in a air raid shelter, and it just affected her. You know, she wasn't a veteran, but her brother was a veteran from the First World War, and he used to stand by the window, and where they lived at the top of a hill, and there was a waste ground opposite them, which was all kind of peppered with the entrances to the old air raid shelters for the Second World War. And he'd stand there and he'd just look for hours. He'd just stand and look. You know, these were real veterans of war, which is occurring now and is going to be occurring for the poor people in Ukraine. And it just strikes me that there are things done, and there were things done for him in the sense that he couldn't breathe either because he'd been gassed in the First World War. So every now and again, they took him off to the sanitarium in the countryside. And I remember very well, because I love this man, he was taken off to the sanatorium and he didn't come back. You know, it had killed him. Eventually the gas had got him. So these are veterans. These are the kind of stories, just not my family. Family after family after the First World War, and now it's happening so terribly in the Ukraine. So I wonder from my own experience, but something that's come up with a question from BJ Brown: what can be done to help siblings caring for the veterans to be helped? They do not receive any of the benefits that spouses receive, to my knowledge, says BJ Brown. So I just wonder about that. There was no help in those days for my family for these sufferers of war. What, as BJ Brown says, what can be done? Do you want to try that, Richard?
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you for for sharing that experience with regards to your family. I think to answer this gentleman's question, it's what's phrased as around family therapy. And you must remember, and this relates to what Professor Scott was just talking about there, is that the inclusion of PTSD didn't happen until 1980 in the DSM-3 Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, which is how we, it's what we use to diagnose mental illnesses. So in terms of this, in terms of engaging and understanding what's going on with individuals, it's taken us some time to understand ourselves as professionals within psychiatry, to understand what's going on. Even though PTSD was first recorded, or an element of PTSD was first recorded in the Battle of Marathon in 490 BC, we're still, we're still not fully understanding it, we're still not fully engaging with it, I think, in so many ways. How you as a sibling can support your loved one is through engaging with the organizations who will give you the skills to be able to understand and to listen. And sometimes we may want to take proactive approaches. And what I mean by that is that actually giving your loved one time and space to be able to talk about the issues. And that's not always on a couch or something like that. It can be engagement we call psychosocial interventions, where we're engaging activities, hiking, things like this, and allowing a non-critical, non-judgmental approach to engaging with that individual about what it is that they're talking about. Because they may find it very difficult to articulate what they've experienced to yourself, who is a civilian. Then if a red flag goes up and you consider that your sibling and this is a real possibility, that there's a suicide risk. And that sounds very harsh to talk about, but it is sadly a reality. Then you have to be prepared to get your sibling support and assistance with that. And again, it may be that the best thing you can be is a companion on that road with your loved one whilst they're engaging with mental health services to get them the support that they may need. But talking and don't be afraid to ask those questions, like around suicide. Are you suicidal? Are you having any thoughts? It sounds very clinical what I'm saying now. You'll know your loved one far better than myself, but engage in those conversations and do things that they enjoy. It's fishing. Go fishing. Sit down and talk things. You'll know your loved one. Okay. And if I can be of any assistance, please feel free to contact me through Sandy or Professor Scott. Thank you.
Can I just say something as well on the back of that, Richard? Thank you. Is also that organisations, obviously family support organisations, they don't just support the direct partners of the veterans. Especially within our organisations that we work for, families can be perceived as even best friends and siblings as well. So you should reach out to other organisations to see if they'll support you too. It's not just partners.
Renee.
Yes, and just to add on to that, I think that might actually be one of those distinctions between different countries treating families of veterans differently. Certainly, I think the question asked related to sort of the difference between how siblings and spouses are given support through policy. And that's certainly true that, we, at least in the United States, there's sort of a structure in place. There's an expectation of, oh yes, you may have a spouse, you may have children, but other people who are close to you who are going to be impacted by the things that happen to the veteran. And I just want to say thank you so much for sharing that experience that you had and talking about your family members and how that affected you. I think that's something that sometimes gets lost in sort of these big policy discussions, is how much it impacts just, you know, one person can then impact all of these people around them, not just their own children, but nieces, nephews, grandchildren, siblings. Mm-hmm. There are a few little pockets of policies in the United States that do provide explicit support for those family members, but they're not many. One that comes to mind is an actually relatively recent program with the VA. It's called the Family Caregiver Program. And so for family members who do not have to be spouses, but family members or people who live with veterans, so for example, a live-in girlfriend or boyfriend could be that caregiver who provide support for seriously disabled veterans. They can get a stipend, they can be get assistance through respite care, training, mental health counseling, but that is a much smaller program, and it's one that's actually been sort of roiled with trouble in terms of how it's been administered. It's only been around for 10 years, and it's gotten a lot of administrative problems as it's been rolled out, and that's another issue that MBLSP has been working a lot in, and we have class actions as well as some other work that we're doing supporting care, not just veterans, but also family caregivers.
Thank you. Travis, did you want to answer on that?
Yeah, I was gonna bring up the caregiver program, but Renee mentioned it better than I think I could. And I think, you know, I was just thinking of this, and our response is a lot of like reach out to organizations and find organizations that support, and IAVA also, we will help family members of veterans just as the same as veterans, cost-free, and connect them to resources that can help them at no cost to themselves. But I think it speaks to the issue how these are kind of ad hoc solutions, and there is no blanket solution if a sibling or somebody who's caring for a veteran, a friend, a loved one, goes to the VA. Well, depending on those kind of legal circumstances of how they're connected, unfortunately, if they go to the VA and say, you know, I have a friend that's a veteran, but they don't want to come to the VA for various reasons, they might be experiencing mental health issues, it can be really hard to find an answer for that, and navigating that very complex bureaucracy can compound those issues. And organizations are incredible, and we need them, and they do a lot of good work. But I think it speaks to the issue of how it is kind of ad hoc, and it is very hard politically to get the will to say, oh, we need to change the law so siblings or best friends can help veterans, because money is always going to be an issue of giving those resources to those people, the type of training that they might need, making sure that they receive good training and to really understand the complexities of the issues, as Richard mentioned. There's a lot of complexities when you're especially talking about mental health. That can go in there, but organizations are great, and I think we need to do more to set up an established system in order to support those who are supporting veterans.
I just wonder whether the political parties in America and the two major political parties in the UK, do they ever have specific policies when they go into the elections related to veterans and to siblings, and to make it known to people about these problems? You know, this is to do with free speech. Are any of the parties particularly foregrounding these issues in America? Let's start in America, Renny.
Sure. I think one of the frustrations that certainly some of the veterans that we work with have is that all political parties, all politicians say, you know, we're pro-veteran, and then the actual details can often be sort of swept away when you're actually dealing with what does that mean? What does that look like? It's a very easy thing to say that you're here to support veterans. It's a lot harder to actually provide that support. I think in terms of, you know, talking specifically about veterans and in particular families, to the extent we're focused on that at the moment, certainly the fact that our current president, President Biden, and Jill Biden, the first lady, are a military family themselves and have that experience. That's the military family issues in particular, I think, is a particular focus of Dr. Jill Biden. And I think that has raised that, elevated some of those conversations in ways that doesn't always happen. But I think it's, you know, even thinking about the burn pit legislation that we were talking about earlier, you know, no one's going to say we don't want to support our veterans, but it's certainly true that a lot of Republicans have said we're pro-veteran, but also this is going to cost a lot, so maybe we shouldn't do it. We support our veterans, but when it comes to actually providing that support, there can be some hesitation because of other concerns and other things that politicians are looking at, not just how do we care for our veterans.
Is that your view, Sean, in the UK? It's muted, Sean, yeah.
It's pretty similar in the UK. I think the veterans' voices are being heard, the families are being heard, and I think a lot of, the government, the Welsh government, even like the senior army as well, that, you know, they're listening and they're wanting to act on it, but obviously it's a lot of red tape and money as well. But that's why there's organisations like ourselves that support the families. And as long as the veterans are being supported, then, you know, we'll do what we can.
Okay, there's a rather long question coming from Ross Shelton. I think it's an important one. Ross says, less than 10% of US veterans see combat. As a veteran myself of the US Coast Guard, a branch of the military with a primarily humanitarian mission, I have never seen combat. As Rennie said, veteranhood is not a monolith. I find it troubling that the veteran identity is constantly and explicitly tethered to the experience of war. But there must be a common thread that unites the veteran experience. Why is it the case that veteran identity is so tokenized? And do you think that this explicit handcuffing serves to further alienate veteran narratives? Well, obviously this is a US issue. Travis, do you want to comment on this?
Yeah, I think this is an issue, and we see the veterans portrayed in media, they are, you know, on the front lines doing all that. And, you know, veterans serve for a long amount of time. And as Ross said, a very small portion of them see combat, but the military isn't, I've always said that the military is not a job, you know, it's a lifestyle. And the military really, the United States military prepares you very well for that lifestyle. And then when you leave that lifestyle, you leave that structure, you have to be up at 0530, you have PT at 0630, you know, chow at et cetera, et cetera. You leave that structure and you're just on your own. I think of my own experience. I did 4 years in the military, joined when I was 18, got out when I was 22, and I went back home across the country to a place with no structure, lived in a studio apartment by myself, and I just kind of had to figure it out. And simultaneously dealing with a lot of these, you know, these issues of what do I do now and all of that, that a lot of veterans face and a lot of just people face at the age of 22. But I think, you know, when the average civilian thinks of a veteran, that's what they think of. And I think we need to do more work within the veteran community and more broadly to speak about the military experience as a whole and to let people know that you are a veteran. You served a day in uniform and you are a veteran. And to Renee's point of people not wanting to say that they're a veteran, That's very challenging, and we need to empower them to let them know that they served and they sacrificed. No matter what level of that sacrifice is, they did sacrifice, and they stood up to defend their country, and their service mattered, and that's important for people to know.
Yeah, so their service mattered, even if they weren't in combat, their support of combat back home. Yes, Judith Bentley, good to hear from you, Judith, in Oxford in the UK. And she says, I wonder if homelessness amongst the veterans is more of an issue for non-commissioned rather than the commissioned. And if so, can this be commented upon? I see you nodding your head there, Richard. Do you wonder?
Yeah, I mean, I was a soldier and a commissioned officer, the research points towards this, that, you know, it is predominantly soldiers, and within the services, it's predominantly Army over Navy and RAF, and it's predominantly infantry. And I think as an explanation, why does this happen? Commissioned officers are usually from upwardly mobile, socially mobile, parts of society. They come from particular geographical areas. They have, when they leave the armed forces, they have greater resources to fall back on than, say, a soldier. And you have to think about recruitment. Where are, so if we look at that very vulnerable population of army, infantry, within that, usually they're what we call in Britain early service leavers, which means that they've been in the armed forces for a shorter period of time, is that our recruitment areas. We recruit from, we recruit from socially deprived areas. You know, it's a rich recruitment ground. You will not get this vulnerable group coming from, localities like in the US, like Hamptons or Martha's Vineyard. You know, I tried recruiting in a place called Knutsford in Cheshire, and I didn't get one soldier. So that sort of tells us that, what age are they when they recruit into the armed, when they come into the armed forces? In the UK, we have a very young age that is able to be recruited into the armed forces. When you think about personality developing, if you think about becoming an adult, and when that happens, and we're saying that's now adolescent ends in the late 20s, that's still going on, where the individual may have gone through the forces and then decided to leave, and they're returning to a community where they may not have been able to establish belonging within that community because they left at a very young age, and then struggle with housing, struggle with a community who doesn't have their experiences, what they went through in the armed forces, struggles to relate. It really is a melting pot of problems that lead that individual then down the route of homelessness. Thank you.
We're coming towards the end, but there's a, sorry, did you want to say something, Sean?
Sorry, I was just going to say what Richard was saying. That was actually my experience when I left the Navy. I joined when I was 16. And if it wasn't the support of my family around me, I 100% would be homeless. I didn't know. It was a lot of events that happened for me to get to that stage. But again, this is, my life experiences that led me to setting up this organisation as well. So, I've definitely been there, and it's moving into a deprived area as well, and not having, the fundamental support, I guess. When I was leaving, I just handed my card in, and that was it. And I joined when I was 16, and then I come out as an adult. So, yeah. I struggled.
Understood. I'll give one more question, because I think it's a very important one. Edward Pfeffer says, have we stepped over the issue of increasing suicide rates among the veteran population in the US? Travis.
Yeah, first I would say that from the data that we have, and the data can be calculated very interestingly, the suicide rate has been steady or decreased a little bit depending on the metrics that you're seeing. It's not a significant decrease, and it's still a very significant problem, not to diminish it by any stretch of the imagination. I just want to make sure that we're using all the same data from the VA that we have. And when talking about this, it is very important. There is still a suicide epidemic among the veteran population. The youngest cohort of veterans, the post 9/11 generation, have the highest rate of suicide. And the Vietnam population in America has the highest numbers of suicide. So it is an incredibly important issue, and it's something that we work on daily. And I've worked on to pass a lot of legislation. And you know, one of the things that I'll plug is we passed the Commander John Scott Hannon Act, who was a veteran who took his own life, and we worked with Senator Tester in order to get this bill passed. And what this bill does, and IAVA's involvement in it, is it's modeled very much after the homelessness program in America, in order to identify veterans who are experiencing homelessness and then connect them with the VA resources. So one of the issues that we see is that veterans might not be going or not might be connected to VA and getting health care that are taking their life. It's a very high rate. I don't know what it is off the top of my head, but they are likely seeking care or seeking some sort of community service somewhere. And these organizations like Sean works with in the UK and we work with here, and to connect those veterans with the life-saving care that VA provides. And VA does provide very good care, because VA understands the veteran experience, as we've been mentioning over and over again, and how important that is for veterans. So the VA can give that specialized care to them. So it is a problem. There is no silver bullet solution. And I'm trying not to rush this answer because it is very important. If anybody else has anything, I think it'd be worth adding.
Anybody else on that one? Well, first of all, I'd like to just say something about free speech, because this is the Free Speech Project. And, you know, when we say it's about veterans, this project is showing how important free speech is. We've all been able to talk today, whereas in Russia, they can't talk at the moment. We have been able to talk because of the values that we have. And I'd pay tribute to Sandy for the project that he runs at Georgetown, that keeps handing and hounding this or banging on about this. We have got to maintain our free speech, and we do that, and we're doing this through this series, but Sandy does it through his project generally. So I pay tribute to you, Sandy. This has been a very, very important program in my view. Anyway, Sandy, would you like to say anything before sure. I close up?
Well, thank you, Mike, for those very touching comments. I think you and I have had an extraordinary experience over this period of time, and discovering that our definition of free speech almost can't be broad enough. It affects every corner of our lives and of lives around the world, and with fewer people living under democratic systems all the time, there's more and more to worry about free speech. Be that as it may, this was really a very touching and wonderful conversation. I appreciate the time people put into it. And it evokes for me some memories that are difficult in my own family that I could have brought up. And that there is definitely an impact. I think it was Travis who said 1% of Americans serve, and it's really a tiny percentage to try to impact a whole population, gain appreciation, and the right to express themselves for those people. So thank you all for joining us today. Also appreciative to the backup we have at Georgetown University. John McCabe, our project manager and editor, has done a very important job in helping us prepare for this program. We have support from Jack DeJoy, the president of Georgetown, Tom Banchoff, our international affairs vice president, and deep into the university's bureaucracy. We'll be doing another program like this in April on the preservation of independent media around the world, a growing and very concerning issue that we've recognized more about during the Ukraine and Russian military horror of the moment. So, Mike, thanks for your collaboration, and thank you all, and I'll turn it back to you.
Okay, well, thank you, Sandy. Thanks to Sean Woodland in the UK, Richard Mottershead in UAE, Travis Hoare and Annie Burbank in the US. Thank you. Thank you all very much. Thanks to you, Sandy, of course. The next free speech project at the Crossroads will be on Monday, the 25th of April. And as Sandy has said, it's to do with the independence of the media. There are two further events which you might like to note. On Tuesday, the 26th of April, at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. BST, Rachel Creswell will be talking about St. Anselm in the Christian Literary Imagination series. Rachel has just recently gained her doctorate from Oxford, and I think you'll find that really interesting to listen to medieval viewpoints. The next event in the China series will be on Friday, the 8th of April, at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. GMT, when Dr. Hayley Ma from the University of Leeds will be discussing opera and theatre in China. And again, this project is about keeping dialogues open through the humanities, through the arts, through conversations and series such as this. We must keep those dialogues open and look at each other's cultures. So she'll be talking about the opera and theatre in China. Thanks to our colleagues in Georgetown. Thanks to our colleagues in Oxford at Campion Hall, Dr. Nick Austin and the Master of the Hall, Sarah Gray and Ying Ying, our Campion Hall administrators. And my thanks, of course, also to John McCabe in Washington, who has helped such a lot. I don't know where we'd be without him. I'd like to thank all of those who have asked questions, all of you who have been participating and attending today. Sanford Ungar is the director of the Free Speech Project at Georgetown University. I'm Professor Mike Scott, Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Until next time, take care, keep safe. Thank you again, everybody.